What you are about to see reveals something fundamental about the world in which we live. Off we go.
Good boy. Good boy. Track.
Trained tracking hound with good nose can follow the tracks of any human being across a field that's been crisscrossed by the tracks of any number of other human beings and can tell the difference. We're marked in some way, all 4 billion of us, by our own individual unique labels. But then again, there's nothing at all unique about being unique. Every creature on the planet is marked in some sense or another as his own individual self.
Lewis Thomas is a distinguished doctor and chancellor of Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York. In two best-selling books, The Lives of a Cell and The Medusa and the Snail, he offered a portrait of nature that is both witty and profound. With his help, we are going to explore how uniqueness and self-identity unite all the creatures who live on this planet.
It was once said by an eminent scientist that a great truth in science is one for which the opposite is also a great truth. And the universal existence in nature, on our kind of planet, of individuality and of uniqueness for all forms of life, may represent that kind of paradox. Here we are, all different and all separate individuals, and yet here we are, all connected and in some way dependent upon each other. Seems to be off on its own, up to its own thing. They're all connected, one way or another. This is the way the world goes round, and it has been going this way, as we shall see, ever since life began. There are some animals that are distinguished from all others because of the individual way they find their own way around in space. And among these, the most fascinating are also among the most ancient of the Earth's creatures, the bacteria. There are some bacteria now being studied by Drs. Blakemore and Frankel that can find their way around by using the Earth's magnetic field. Inside the bacterium are dark crystals of iron arranged in a lovely string. The string converts the bacterium into a sort of compass needle. This organism lives deep in the mud, so it has to find its way down. Its compass points it north, toward the magnetic pole. And to swim in that direction, it must, of course, swim down. The setup here is a magnet in both sides of a microscopic slide that contains a sample of the organism growing in that kind of mud. This, under the present circumstances, is the North Pole, and on this side is the South Pole. And as I look at it, I can see if the switch is thrown this way, all of the organisms are swimming in straight lines in this direction. And then if I switch it the other way, they turn around in very tight U-turns and go back in the opposite direction. And I can do it again and move them that way. Absolutely marvelous sense of power. And if I do it again, I can turn them around again. And that, apparently, one can do all day long. And I sort of think I could do it all day long. I can swing them back and forth and make them do exactly what I want them to do. I am, in a certain sense, magnetized by the phenomenon myself.
Other bacteria are sensitive to light. Watch what happens. The bacteria know where the light is, and they cluster together beneath it. It's just one of the ways in which bacteria can behave purposefully. Here is another. The tube is filled with a chemical that the bacteria like. Slowly but surely, they begin moving towards it in a bright cloud like a halo. Speed it up 10 times. The movement of the bright cloud is even more dramatic. The way bacteria swim has its surprises too. When they are brightly illuminated, a bundle of filaments, the flagella, can be seen. It used to be thought that flagella beat, but they don't. They rotate, driven round and round by tiny motors. When the motors turn one way, the bacteria swim in straight lines. But when they reverse, the bacterium tumbles as the bundle flies apart. Here it happens again. There was a further astonishing discovery made in Dr. Daniel Koshland's laboratory in Berkeley. In this experiment, the flagella are stuck down so the bacteria's bodies rotate instead. All these bacteria are genetically identical and they were grown in an identical environment. Yet each one rotates consistently in its own special time, some faster, some slower than others, but always the same. These simple cells display both individuality and uniqueness in their behavior.
Looking at bacteria, and now we're on our way into a different world, what we like to call higher forms of life. Bacteria are, of course, individual cells, but the creatures we'll be looking at are individuals that make use of the information contained in individuality. They can tell themselves from other somewhat similar cells, and they use that kind of information to stick together and to form, at least for the time being, a solid organism. Okay.
The creatures are found with a variety of other animals on the ocean floor. Finding them required the special talents of John Valois at the Marine Biological Laboratory in Woods Hole.
Dr. Thomas, we have a wide variety of specimens in this collection. We have some tubularia, which is sometimes referred to as sea hay.
Yeah.
And we have starfish. Now, we don't always find starfish just in this bottom because it's not a good bottom for bivalves.
Yeah.
But somehow or other, they're drifting out. Oh, here's what we want. This is what we've come for. Here's a piece of Cliona sulfur sponge. Now, everything has three names. It has the genus name, the scientific name, it has the common name, and then it has the sailor's name.
Yeah.
This is monkey dung. That's the sailor's name.
Yeah.
Sulfur sponge, the common
not
name.
Not a bad name.
That's not bad. The sailors are very poetic in what they do.
This is the game. This is what we're after. Great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, we've got two different kinds of sponge here. This one, spectacularly red. This one, lumpy and yellow. Fundamentally, they're the same kind of animal. They've got a very primitive set of cell types. Cells that are amoeboid and crawl through the structure. Other cells that are arranged with cilia and beak in order to carry water in through the vents and out again. Although they look fairly solid, they come apart very easily. And once you have a small fragment like this, it's an easy matter to divide it up so that all the cells become separate. You can do this by, I've just learned how to do it, squeezing them through this very fine mesh. And I think you can see, as I do this, that the water is becoming very turbid by a suspension of single cells. I can do the same thing with a fragment, which I don't think hurts very much, and then squeeze it so fashion. Now, if you leave these preparations like that, they will find each other again, especially if you rotate the dish gently. And in 2 or 3 days, they will reform small but unmistakably morphologically bona fide sponges, a red sponge in this dish and yellow sponge fragments, aggregates in that dish. So the real question is, what will happen when you mix the two together and have in this dish now red sponge cells all separate from each other and yellow sponge cells all separate?
When they are teased apart, the cells lack color, but they still know who they are. The two different kinds seek out themselves with absolute certainty. Within a few hours, tiny sponge-like structures begin to form. It's a process that's carried on privately. Red and yellow cells ignore one another as they assemble themselves once more. Other animals use their sense of themselves to stay separate. Dr. Liz Francis of Bates College, Maine, has uncovered an unexpected example on the beaches of Santa Cruz.
We're walking in the intertidal zone here, on rocks with sand behind us and surf. What we find is very, very dense communities of animals. Probably the most common animal here is the mussels, the barnacles living on top of them. Very small ones down the crevices, very large ones on top. These are gooseneck barnacles. They feed by stretching their feet out, combing the water. Then growing all around, you see various kinds of algae, very different kinds. Here's the most common one probably, which is fucus. And then packed in among all this, you find a little bit of rock space. This looks like rock space, but in fact, you find there's a crust of algae even on it. And this stuff that looks like sand isn't really sand at all. It's closed up sea anemone, packed side by side by side here, closed up because the tide's out. Water's gone, so this closed right down. What I noticed about the anemones that really intrigued me was the fact that you've got spaces among these dense beds of anemones. And if you look carefully, you find the spaces run completely around any given group. People used to think that these were trails, perhaps, made by some of these organisms over here, the snails wandering between the anemones and keeping these spaces open, grazing down the algae. But I didn't really believe that. I got kind of interested in what was going on there, and it occurred to me that perhaps there was some difference between the anemones on one side and the anemones on the other side of the space. For example, if you look closely when this guy was open, you might find he had pink-tipped tentacles. And if you looked at this one, you'd find, sure enough, it has pink-tipped tentacles too. And in fact, all the animals in a given clump would have exactly the same color markings on them. These animals reproduce asexually as well as sexually, and you find that an animal just split in half, leaving two animals that have exactly the same history, essentially. And so, like genetically identical humans, identical twins, they'll have all the same color patterns, like blue eyes, for example. In this case, pink-tipped tentacles. If you look and find one of them to be female, you find all the rest are female there. What we've got is one genetic individual here separated into little pieces, but they don't mingle with the other individuals. In other words, these gaps seem clearly to separate and keep separate genetically separate individuals and why. I got very curious about why that was happening.
Dr. Francis made an astonishing discovery. The anemones have an exquisite sense of self-identity. Members of the same clone would sit happily together, side by side. But when individuals from different clones met, something extraordinary occurred. With a single touch of their tentacles, the anemones could tell there was a stranger nearby.
The two anemones you're looking at are from two different clones. It's fairly obvious if you look at their tentacle tips. The one on the right has very pink-tipped tentacles, and the one on the left is all kind of brown. I just brought them into contact. Their tentacles touched and twitched back. The one on the left is starting to writhe a little bit. And as we watch, the tentacles will reach out again, come into contact, and twitch back again. The beginning's very, very slow of this kind of encounter. You have to be very patient to work on anemones. The animal with pink-tipped tentacles now is starting to respond. You can see its tentacles are drawn back a bit. At the base of those tentacles, you see some white bits, which are specialized organs that are used for fighting. The pink-tipped animal's very slowly leaning over the brown animal. And you can see those white organs, the acarajae, inflating. Actually, the one without the pink-tipped tentacles now is starting to respond. He's tilting backwards. And also at the base of his tentacles, you see these acarajae inflating. There should be contact pretty soon. The animal with the brown tentacles is curving in toward the animal with the pink tentacles. The animal with pink tentacles is swooping down on him. The actual damage is done by those white-tipped organs. There it goes. You see the pink-tipped animal twitch, stretching out again. They ought to make contact again pretty soon. Leaning over, beginning to make contact with the other animal. There he goes. The other animal's contracted, pulling down in. What usually happens then is that the damaged animals move apart. So if you have a clear winner, then the clear loser backs off. And that's what causes those cleared areas between clones.
Fights are dramatic, but why do they occur?
The rocks out there are essentially crowded living spaces, spaces where the animals can capture the food that's coming on the waves to them, and so animals are competing all the time to sit down and live there. And the anemone's trick for doing that is to just keep growing and spread across the rock. And the way they do this is to divide and grow and divide and grow until they coat an area side by side, and eventually, of course, there's going to be another group of anemones doing the same thing. And where that happens, you get wars, essentially, between the two groups of anemones coming together, the two clones. So the lines that we were looking at are not really snail trails at all. They're war zones where the two clones meet each other and fight over space along that strip.
Anemones use signs of selfness in disputes over space. Other creatures use personal messages with quite different ends in mind. This is a male blue crab. It's built like a tank, and it's quite as fierce as its appearance suggests. This kind of ferocity is not restricted to blue crab's prey. But when it's time to mate, the crab's aggression melts away. The female releases a pheromone, a chemical message intended solely for blue crab males, and its effects are extraordinary. Now the male offers the gentlest possible care. Before she can mate, the female must molt. By cradling her in his arms, the male protects her until that occurs. The molting may take several days, but finally the female emerges. Vulnerable, but available. Female blue crabs mate just once, although getting around to it, with 16 legs in the way, makes it no easy affair.
Information system used by the blue crab is, in a certain sense, a specific chemical message in that it informs a male blue crab that there is in the vicinity a female who is about to molt and therefore is in need of shelter and protection. It is, however, not specific for the individual crab. There are, however, other organisms with highly specific and specifically personal messages to deliver.
The sounds of individuality surround us in the songs of birds. Why birds sing and how their songs are individual has been explored by Dr. Peter Marler.
Well, I'm standing here on the edge of this meadow in upper New York State, the middle of May, surrounded by all of these birds in song. There are yellow warblers and song sparrows all along the edge of the creek here, singing their heads off. And then out on the meadow here, there are red-winged blackbirds and swamp sparrows all singing, proclaiming their presence. They're using the songs to stake out their turf and to claim a piece of territory that they'll use for breeding, to attract females, and basically to organize the societies in which they're living.
Many of us can distinguish the song of a blackbird from that of a sparrow. Birds themselves can do much more. This is a sound spectrograph of the swamp sparrow song, and here is the song of a second individual. It's the same song, but the two versions vary in detail. Differences in the notes and syllables visible here reflect the individual qualities of the two birds. They are a consequence of the complex way birds acquire their songs.
If you rear a swamp sparrow, for example, in isolation so that he never has an opportunity to hear the natural song, he will develop his own song on schedule, but it will be quite abnormal. On the other hand, if you give him an opportunity to listen to normal song for a quite short period when he's young, he will commit it to memory, and then come the spring, he'll begin to sing, and he begins with what we call sub-song. You can see from this display that it's a very rambling, amorphous kind of sound here. Search as you may, you don't find any sign of imitations of the songs that the bird memorized when it was young.
Within a few weeks, fragments of song appear. The bird tries out arrangements of sounds. Some are imitations of the song it heard, but other syllables are pure invention.
There, above all, you're seeing the production of material that is unique to the individual. It's in some way manifesting some feature of its own individuality in this process of vocal invention.
Finally, the full song appears. It's unquestionably a swamp sparrow song, yet it's sung uniquely with the voice of a particular bird. Birds themselves are well aware of these individual differences, and they react to them in wholly appropriate ways. Here's the song of a red-winged blackbird. It's a stranger's song played in a territory of another bird.
We've drawn in two males. They're responding partly to the playback and partly to one another. Now one of them's driven off, and you can see the resident is in full display now in response to the playback. Now this male is coming in more closely, and I think what we'll find is that he'll begin to sing in counterpoint to the songs that we're playing to him. If you play the song of a given neighbor back from that neighbor's territory, he will just sing in reply. If, on the other hand, you take that same song and play it from the other side of his territory, so it's the right song but in the wrong place, then he'll respond more aggressively, as though he senses that that particular individual is misplaced and is perhaps a potential threat to his territory.
The voices of birds are as distinctly personal as our own. And we too are stamped as individuals in ways we ourselves don't recognize.